So in the last class, we have covered k-means clustering, k-medoid clustering, and also we have entered into the concept of hierarchical clustering. So in hierarchical clustering, two ways are there. Agglomerative method is there and divisive method is there. In agglomerative method, initially we have started with individual data points as clusters, and by applying some iterative process, we are going to merge the clusters until you get the single cluster or until certain criterion satisfies. And to merge the clusters, we need to find out the similarity among the clusters. That can be done by finding the Euclidean distance between the nearest points among the clusters. Similarly, in case of divisive, there also initially the process starts with a single cluster, single large cluster, and after that, based on the Euclidean distance, larger Euclidean distance, that means maximum Euclidean distance among the cluster, among the objects, the cluster is divided into subclusters, and this process repeats until certain criteria satisfied. So like this, we are having two methods under one method is under divisive and one method is under agglomerative. In the last class, we have discussed all those, and we are having some metrics also, some similarity metrics also there by using average, minimum distance, maximum distance, etc. And now, what is the drawback in hierarchical clustering? See here, the decision of split or merge is very difficult in case of hierarchical clustering. That means if you consider the agglomerative, you need to split or merge. You need to merge the clusters. So which two clusters we need to merge, that is a decision. So in case of divisive clustering, you need to split the clusters. So at which point we need to split, that is the decision. So that particular decision is very critical in the hierarchical clustering. Why? Because once the decision is taken, and once the action, respective action is taken, and the process is proceeded for the next iteration, if at all it is known that after entering into the next iteration, it is known that the split point or the merge point is wrong. What we have did in the previous iteration is wrong. We can't undo the action. We can't go back and just like in k-medoids, we can go back and we can choose the another representative. Here, that is not the case. Once you split the data or once you merge the data, and once you proceed for the next iteration, we can't undo the action and we can't come back and we can't rectify the problem. So that is the major drawback in hierarchical clustering. That's why we can go for multiple hierarchical clustering where you can integrate the hierarchical clustering method with the other existing method so that you can get the good clusters with good quality. Screen is visible, right? So this is all we have seen in the last class. Agnes is a method under agglomerative approach, and Diana is a method under divisive approach. And he, using this tree-like structure, you can observe the pictorial representation of the process of agglomerative and divisive. And here, dendrogram is also there for a clear understanding of the process of clustering, and it also consisting of some similarity scale, which tells us based on that means the level of similarity among the clusters. So, from this graph, from this dendrogram, we can able to get the process of clustering. So, these are some measures used for estimating the similarity among the clusters, and here. So here we have already discussed a difficult drawback of hierarchical clustering, that is difficulty regarding the selection of merge and split points. That is one drawback, and another point is it is not scalable well. So in case of large databases, it is not suitable. Why? Because it needs to analyze each and every point of the data set to understand the split point and to understand the merge point. So it is very complex. It is very complicated in case of large databases. So to avoid these two drawbacks, as a solution for these two drawbacks, we are moving for the multi-phase clustering. That is also a kind of hierarchical, but little modified version of the hierarchical clustering, that is multi-phase clustering. So in which hierarchical clustering is added with some other clustering algorithm, so that it consisting of two methods. Hierarchical partitioning is done, and in coming to the clustering process, any kind of existing clustering method can be used there. And under this, we are having three methods. Bridge is there, rock, and chameleon. So all these three methods come as hierarchical clustering, especially multi-phase hierarchical clustering. So coming to the Bridge method, so here, Bridge is a balanced iterative reducing and clustering using hierarchies. So just go through the name again, Bridge is a balanced iterative. That means for generating the final cluster, some iterative process is going on, is there, carried out by the Bridge. And it is balanced. Balanced in the sense, there exists certain kind of threshold to balance the cluster generation process. Balanced, iterative, reducing. Reducing in the sense that threshold, that fixed threshold may be reduced if necessary. That threshold may be reduced if necessary. Reducing and clustering using hierarchies. Obviously, we are going to use hierarchical clustering in that we are going to merge hierarchical clustering with the other clustering algorithms. So that is multiple phase clustering. In that, we are now discussing about the Bridge clustering. So it is balanced iterative, reducing and clustering using hierarchies. So here, what actually solved by the Bridge algorithm? For what it is evolved as a solution for the major problems of the existing clustering methods. First of all, what are the major problems, major drawbacks of the existing clustering methods? So here, if you see, many of the clustering methods are not cope up with the large data sets. Just now also we have discussed. It cannot cope up with the large data sets, or if they cannot be efficient if at all the memory is very small. So in such cases, Bridge can be used because it can cope up with the large databases also. That means it can dynamically modify, its functionality is dynamically modified according to the main memory requirement. So if at all we're having high memory, more memory, according to that, the algorithm is constructed. If at all we're having low memory, according to that, it is the algorithm is shrinked according to that. So it is dynamic in nature, and it is some algorithms are there which are not which are sensitive to the memory size. So this is not like that. And again, here we are having minimizing the number of scans of the data set. So if you consider any of the previous algorithms, they need to go through the too many scans of the data set to finally form the clusters. Whereas here, which maximum take one scan of the data set to form the clusters. So using Bridge, we can minimize the number of database scans. And the last drawback of the previous existing methods, and at the same time, last advantage of the Bridge is I/O costs are very high in case of existing methods. So this can be solved using Bridge. Since in case of large data sets, the existing algorithms, what they can do is they can bring some part of the data set into the main memory and performing some processing and some clustering they can perform, and again swapping the utilized data set and the not utilized data set to and from the memories and performing certain process like that. The existing clustering methods may lead to very high I/O cost, whereas in case of Bridge, since it is dynamically adjusted with respect to the memory available, there is no place for the I/O cost. So it causes very low I/O cost. So that is all little about the Bridge, and it can be understood better by going through the examples. So here it introduces two concepts. There are two concepts associated with the bits algorithm. The first one is clustering feature, which is called as CF, and second one is clustering feature tree, CF tree. So before constructing the bits algorithm, we need to know about these two, clustering feature and clustering feature tree. This is all about bits. You need to know about this before knowing about the bits algorithm, the process of bits algorithm. So here these two are like a kind of data structure for representing the clusters. Especially as the name itself indicates, this is clustering feature tree and this is clustering feature. That means it's a kind of, it includes a kind of feature for the existing clusters. So whatever you have, what clusters you have with you, the features of, that means the characteristics, the statistics of all the clusters, how many data points are there in the cluster, what is the average value of the data points in the cluster, what is the diameter of the cluster, what is the radius of the cluster, etc. Every detail can be carried out by this clustering feature, CF. Feature in the sense characteristics. So the basic statistical information regarding a cluster can be carried out by this clustering feature, CF. And next, coming to the clustering feature tree, we are having a tree, as the name itself indicates, it's a kind of tree, and where each node, each leaf node and each non-leaf node contains some kind of data in terms of this clustering feature. So let us see what is this in depth, let us see what kind of data it consists of. This CF holds what kind of data. Broadly, we know that the all kind of statistical information regarding a cluster can be held by the CF. Particularly, is there any syntax for that structure, and how to develop the CF tree, we'll see now. So here, so CF can be represented with a triplet. It consisting of three parameters, N, LS, and SS. Where N indicates the number of objects of a cluster. If at all your cluster consisting of 10 objects, then N indicates 10. Where LS is the linear sum of the objects of the cluster, where SS is the squared sum of the objects of the cluster. And the formulas are also given here. Linear sum in the sense, directly you can add all the object values of the cluster. Squared sum in the sense, before adding, you need to square the value and you need to add. So these three parameters in terms of a triplet are held by this CF, cluster feature. And next, this CF entry is a summary of statistics of the cluster, as we have discussed. It's a kind of representation of the cluster, and it has sufficient information to calculate the centroid, radius, diameter, whatnot regarding the cluster. So whatever you want to calculate for a particular cluster, no need to go for each and every data point of the cluster again and again. You can directly take the triplet of the cluster, that means CF of the cluster, and from that CF representation you can able to generate all the values. Centroid you can able to find from that, and radius you can able to find, diameter you can able to find like that. And lastly, additively theorem allows us to merge subclusters incrementally. Suppose we are having one cluster here, and this is indicated with CF1, clustering feature 1, and this is indicated with CF2. And during the process of constructing the algorithm, this hierarchical clustering algorithm, if at all you want to merge these two clusters, then what is the CF generated for the resulting cluster? What is the CF generated for the resulting cluster? So what they are telling is the resulted, that means the new CF can be obtained from the by adding the CFs of the existing subclusters. So this is the additive theorem. Here, if you observe that, but did you get my voice? Everything is fine, right? Screen is visible, right? Just give some.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So here. So if you observe here, you have cluster 1 with the three points indicated with this, and we're having cluster 2 with 3 data points, and this is the CF of this cluster. What is the CF? It's a triplet, and the first value, first parameter indicates the number of objects of the cluster. So how many objects are there in cluster 1? How many objects are there in cluster 1?
3, ma'am.
Yes, number 3 is there. Number 3 is there or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Ma, how many objects are there in cluster 1?
3 objects, ma'am.
In cluster 2?
3 objects, ma'am.
Keep in line. So here, what is the triplet format? We're having CF format is, first we're having n, number of objects, and linear sum and squared sum. This is the triplet representation of a cluster feature. So here is 3. And what is this? How we can obtain this? Linear sum. Linear sum in the sense 2 plus 3 plus 4, comma 5 plus 2 plus 3. And this is the squared sum. That means 2 square plus 3 square plus 4 square, like this. So by solving this, we can get this. And number 3, how to get this? How to get this 35 and 36 here in case of cluster 2? How we can get 35 and 36 there? I don't want any value, I just want the process. So similar to the cluster 1, here also we are having 3 data points. And for that also, we need to add all the first elements that gives the 35 value, and all the second element, by adding all the second elements, linear summation of the second element, you can get the 36 value. Similarly, this 417 and 440. So by having a square sum of the first values, so in this example, they won't give the data value. I'm just asking the process. We can get the 417. Similarly, by adding the square sum of the second values, you can get the 440. Now, number 3, how to get this CF3? How to get this value? What is CF3 actually? Sare, ippudu vinandi. Next, nenu emana adigithe mimmalni adugutanu. Arthamainda, number 3.
Okay, ma'am.
So, follow from now. నెక్స్ట్ క్వశ్చన్ ఏదైనా ఉంది అంటే మీరే చెప్పాలి. ఓకే, నెంబర్ 37.
Yes, ma'am.
So how we are getting CF3?
CF1 plus CF2, ma'am.
So we need to add the individual values. So once you club these two clusters, how many elements you may have? Six elements, because you are having here 3 and here 3, total 6 you can get. And after that, what is this LS? By adding this 35 with 9, right? And 36 with 10. You can get 44 and 46, right? And next, by adding 417 with 49 and 440 plus 38, you can get this value. Like that, you can, if at all two subclusters are merged to form a one big cluster, it's equivalent. Clustering feature can also be obtained by adding the two CFs of the subclusters. This is the way. And these are some distance measures we have. So to calculate the centroid, you can, this is directly formula for calculating the mean and centroid, all those are synonyms. And coming to the radius and diameter. So here radius is obtained in this way. So which is nothing but the average distance between the any point of the cluster to its mean. That is the radius. Whereas coming to the diameter, it is the average distance between the any two points of the cluster. So that is also called pairwise distance. So what they're telling, once you have the CF for a particular cluster, you can get automatically from that data, you can get automatically mean of the cluster, radius of the cluster, diameter of the cluster, etc., etc. And this is all about the CF clustering feature. And coming to the CF tree, clustering feature tree. So it's a kind of tree. As usual, tree consisting of what? It may consisting of fruit, root node is there, some intermediate nodes are there, that means some non-leaf nodes are there and some leaf nodes are there, right? So here also it's a kind of tree consisting of all these levels, root, first level, second level, so on down, and finally we are having leaf level. But in every level is dealt with the CF of a cluster, clustering feature of a cluster, and along with some associated constraints. Constraints is nothing but some conditions are there for a CF tree. So first of all, this is the height balanced tree, and this CF tree can be constructed by going through the single scan of the database. So this is the first phase of the BITCH algorithm. So while going through the single scan of the database, this algorithm constructs a CF tree by following certain given constraints like threshold value, branching factor value, and L value. Like that, we are having certain constraints for this CF tree. And what are those constraints? How to generate these? Let us see. So it's a height balanced tree with two parameters. It consisting of one is branching factor B, and other one is threshold. It consisting of two parameters. One is branching factor. Branching factor, in the sense, as the name itself indicates, that it dealt with the branching decision, whether to branch now or not, to continue or we can continue. Or it dealt with the branching decision, and this threshold dealt with the diameter and radius of a particular cluster. And so here, each non-leaf node contains at most b entries of the form. So before going through all this description, let me first directly explain this by showing an tree. So this is an example of the CF tree. I'm going. I just went back after having a brief view of this CF tree. Okay, I will be back. So here we are having some root node. Root node contains some set of CF, where each CF represents its child. Each CF is corresponding to its child. How many CFs are there? B number of CFs are there in root node. So we are here B is called as a branching factor. Here B is called as a branching factor. So that means if at all the B value is 3, which means that in this particular CF tree, a maximum of 3 children can be allowed for a node. If at all there are 4 children, that particular node need to be split. For example, here we are having, here is certain node, and we are having 2 children right now. As this is a dynamically growing algorithm, as the data is added dynamically, one more child also there, also added to this node, if at all. If suppose one more child is also added to that node. So till that, there is no problem, because the branching factor is equal to 3. So maximum of we are having 3 children. And as the time moves, one more child is also added, need to be added to this particular node. Here it violates the branching factor B. Why? Because according to the branching factor, a node consisting of only B number of children. Here in this example, B is equal to 3. So if at all here it exceeds 3, it needs to be split. This node needs to be split into 2 nodes. So here, if suppose this is A, this is split into A and or A bar and A double bar, like this. And again, we are having some parent node here. That means as the data is added, the length of the tree is also growing, increasing. Like that, this branching factor decides whether to branch out or not. Like that. So that is associated with a non-leaf node. any kind of, that means that may be the root node or that may be the intermediate row, intermediate node, any kind of non-leaf node is associated with a branching factor B. So according to that only, the tree can be growing. And after that, since here also this is a root node and this is a non-leaf node and this is the, here is the leaf node. So here we need to have a maximum of B number of CF. And coming to the children, each CF is indicated with, represented with, associated with a child. And here is a CF, we are having child here. And here is a CF having some child here. Here is a CF, we are having some child here. Like this, each CF is associated with a child. And again, coming to the next level, whether it may be the leaf node or non-leaf node, coming to the next level, that means for each child, if at all it is not a leaf node, again, it consisting of some number of CFs. How many maximum number of CFs are allowed here? B number of branching factor is there. Again, each CF is associated with a child node. Again, each CF is associated with a children. So like this, a maximum of B children are allowed for this particular non-leaf node. If suppose this is also a non-leaf node. Here in this example, this is the leaf node. The level 3 is the leaf node, but if suppose this is also a non-leaf node, again the same step. Again, each child is associated with some B number of CF until you get the leaf node. If suppose the next step is the leaf node, then each child in the leaf node is associated with some set of clusters. Some set of subclusters are there, where each cluster is having some clustering feature. So here we are not having enough clusters. In the upper levels, we are not having any kind of clusters. We are only having some structure of the cluster. Only clustering features we are having. Whereas in case of leaf node, every leaf node is associated with some set of clusters. Some set of clusters. How many set of clusters are there? So for each leaf node, there should be maximum of L number of clusters, L number of subclusters. So that's why how many CFs we are having, CF1, CF2, so on, and CFL. So in each leaf node, we may have maximum of L number of clusters, L number of subclusters, where each subcluster is represented again with a clustering feature, CF1, CF2, like this. And here you have branching factor B, and here you have L. And one more thing, we are having threshold that is associated with a particular cluster. Threshold is associated with a particular cluster, which tells that the details regarding the diameter and radius of the cluster. So by following that threshold only, we are having clusters here in the leaf node. If at all you are going to, suppose you are having some data point X and you are going to add this data point to this cluster, for example. You are going to add this data point to this first cluster. So by adding this data point, the radius or diameter of the cluster is increases beyond the threshold, then that particular group need to be split into two clusters. That particular group need to be split into two clusters. If at all the addition of X to that particular cluster changes the radius or diameter such that the changed threshold satisfies the given threshold, then there is no problem. You can directly add that X to the first cluster. Otherwise, you need to split the cluster into two clusters. Like this, there is some incremental process carried out for this particular tree. So don't get confused. We are having some set of examples to get the to make you more familiar with this algorithm, no problem. So here, what I'm telling is we are having just like a casual tree, we are having certain root nodes and certain intermediate nodes. That means non-leaf nodes we are having, and finally leaf nodes we are having. So all leaf nodes are associated with the subclusters. All leaf nodes are associated with the subclusters. And all parent clusters, parent nodes have links to this leaf nodes. All parent nodes have links to this leaf nodes. And the information about the leaf nodes is associated with the parent nodes in terms of CF. And there is a double linked list between each child node. If you observe, not child node, each leaf node. So if you observe here, there is a double linked list between each leaf node. So this is briefly about the CF tree. We're having mostly two parameters are there. Branching factor that decides the number of children for a parent node. And we're having threshold is there. Threshold actually decides the diameter and radius of a particular cluster in the leaf node. And we're having one more parameter L is there, which decides the number of clusters in a leaf node. Did you get the difference between B, T and L? Anybody tell me what is B and what is T and what is L? If you don't get the difference, no problem. Since this is the first time I'm explaining, if at all anybody have a clear idea about what is B, what is T, what is L, please open up. ఎవరికి అర్థం కాలేదా? చెప్పండి 37.
బి మీన్స్ బ్రాంచింగ్ ఫ్యాక్టర్ మ్యామ్. ఎల్ అంటే నెంబర్ ఆఫ్ సబ్ క్లస్టర్స్ ఎన్ని ఉండాలి అని చెప్పింది మ్యామ్.
ఓకే
అంటే మ్యామ్
సో బి ఏం చెప్తుంది బ్రాంచింగ్ ఫ్యాక్టర్?
నెంబర్ ఆఫ్ బ్రాంచెస్ మ్యామ్.
నెంబర్ ఆఫ్
బ్రాంచెస్
బ్రాంచెస్ కన్నా చిల్డ్రన్ అంటే కొంత టెక్నికల్ వర్డ్. సో నెంబర్ ఆఫ్ చైల్డ్స్ ఇస్ ఇండికేటెడ్ విత్ B, and as you said, number of subclusters in a leaf is indicated with the
L, ma'am.
And T indicates the that means B is constrained on the number of chains, L is constrained on the number of clusters, where T is a constraint on a specific cluster.
Okay, ma'am.
Its diameter, its radius. That means the what should be the radius of the maximum radius, that means what should be the maximum radius of the formed cluster in a leaf node, and what should be the maximum radius of a maximum diameter of a cluster in the leaf node. Like that, this is a constraint on the specific subcluster. So like okay. That we're having three constraints, and by obeying all the constraints we can develop the CF tree. So this all process should be done in the first scan of the database itself. So let me go back. Yes. So it is a the BITCH algorithm builds a clustering feature tree while scanning the dataset, and it is a height balanced tree with two parameters. Basically, we are telling that only two parameters we are having: branching factor and threshold. So each non-leaf node, just imagine a CF tree in your mind while reading this, while going through this PPT. Just imagine a CF tree and try to map the words with that what we have discussed just now. So each non-leaf node contains at most B entries of the form CF5, child, where child I is a pointer to its ith child node, and CF5 is a CF of a subcluster represented by this chain, where CF is the CF of the subcluster represented by the chain. So each parent node, what it consisting of? B number of entries, max B number of entries it consisting of, and each parent node have CS of the child along with the link to its child. So that is what here it is telling. So a non-leaf node represents a cluster made up of all the subclusters represented by its entries. So a leaf node contains at most m entries, each of them of the form CFI, where I is equal to 1 to L. So how many maximum number of entries are allowed for a leaf node? L. So it also has two pointers, previous and next, which are used to chain all leaf nodes together for efficient scans. We have already go through this, right? There exists a double link list between the leaf nodes. That is what here. Previous and double link list includes these two pointers, previous pointer and the next pointer. So a leaf node also represents a cluster made up of all the subclusters represented by its entries. So actually a leaf node is like this. This is a leaf node, this is a leaf node, where each leaf node is having some subclusters. This is cluster 1, this is cluster 2, this is cluster 3. Like this, you are having a leaf node where each leaf node is represented with a subcluster. So that's why the leaf node consisting of the clustering features of all these subclusters. So actually it is look like this, CF1, CF2, CF3, because it's consisting of three clusters, we are having three clustering features, right? Whereas the parent of this leaf node consisting of, again, since this is a cluster, right? This is a cluster, so its parent consisting of the clustering information of this global cluster. These are the subclusters. So this is the big cluster. This is the big cluster, right? So this clustering feature is contained along with the parent node. So the parent node consisting of the clustering feature of this, of its child. So here, a leaf node also represents a cluster made up of all the subclusters represented by its entries. But all entries in a leaf node must satisfy a threshold requirement with respect to a threshold value T. We already know that, right? Each entry of a leaf node should satisfy a threshold requirement. Each entry, in the sense, one entry is equal to one cluster in the leaf node. So the diameter or radius has to be less than T. So this we have already gone through. And the tree size is a function of T, and larger the T is, the smaller the tree is. So if the threshold is high, the size of the tree is very less. Why so? If the threshold is high, the size of the tree is less.
Endukante reach ayye notes undali kada ma'am, andukane
reach ayye notes, in the sense
diameter and center ekku untadi kada ma'am.
So threshold ekku, largest threshold, in the sense indirectly largest diameter, largest radius of a cluster. So if at all you have a large cluster, the size of the tree is reduced. If at all you are having small clusters, that means the height of the tree is increased. Previously, just now I told regarding this, I think. Here if you observe, example. Here in this example, this is the actual tree. Whenever you add one thing, some new cluster, whenever you add into the tree, since it's a threshold, it crosses the threshold, it needs to be split into the two nodes, due to which height of the tree is also increased and size of it also increased. If at all its parameters, suppose its branching factor is 4 and its threshold is also good enough, it can accept 4 children, then there is no need to increase the size of the tree. So here this tree is having less size and this tree is having some little more size, like that. And the same example will be repeated in the next slides also, don't worry. So because of this, as the threshold increases, size of the tree decreases, or as the threshold decreases, size of the tree increases. So for this, how can this Birch algorithm, how it can handle the handle in case of there is a very less memory available. So what is the technique here? If at all there is a less memory, it increases the threshold value. In case of it is sufficient memory is there, it decreases the threshold value. Like that, it can able to handle all the things. So here the leaf contains the actual clusters, and the size of any cluster in a leaf is not larger than T. This we already know that. And here is the CF3 insertion process. Just listen carefully. Here is the CF3 insertion process. So it starts with the root node, and it finds the CF entry in the root closest to the data point, move to the chain, and repeat the process until a closest leaf entry is formed. So at the leaf, if the point can be accommodated in the cluster, update the entry. If this addition violates the threshold T, split the entry. If this violates the limit imposed by L, split the leaf. If its parent node 2 is full, split that, and so on. So update the CF entry from the root to the leaf to accommodate this point. Let me explain this by sharing a whiteboard. Here three things we need to consider while inserting into the tree. For example, here we are already having, for example, B is equal to some 3 and L is equal to some 2, for example. I think we are having an example in the in PPT itself, we are having an example. So leave this part, I will again come back and explain. So here is an example. I will explain these things again. So here initially you are having a cluster, right? So as the data is added, if at all it exceeds the threshold. So observe here. Here initially you are having a cluster here. So it satisfies the threshold. That means the size of the cluster, size in the sense, so the radius and the diameter of the cluster satisfies the given threshold. If at all dynamically some other point is added to the cluster, and unfortunately its size increases more than the threshold, then what we need to do? We need to split the cluster into two clusters, right? Like this. We need to split the cluster into two clusters. And after that, two clusters in the sense, we need to create a parent node. Like that, you need to build the tree. If at all you are adding one more point, if at all by adding one more point to this particular cluster, here cluster A is there, cluster B is there, and I'm adding one more point to this B. If at all it satisfies the threshold, after adding one point to the B, the resulting total cluster satisfies the threshold, then there is no problem. Still we are having two clusters. If at all I am adding the third cluster, if it does not satisfy the threshold, then again we need to split. So here, split in the sense, we are talking about three things. Branching factor is there, L is there, threshold is there. So split may be happened at any point of place, like for example, just wait. So here, split maybe happened at three places. You need to get that first. Associated with, split is associated with B, L, T. మీరు ఈ పాయింట్ బాగా ఫోకస్ చేయండి. ఇన్ ఏ ట్రీ దెర్ ఆర్ త్రీ సిచ్యువేషన్స్ టు స్ప్లిట్. ఎక్కడెక్కడ మనం స్ప్లిట్ చేయొచ్చు ట్రీని, స్ప్లిట్ చేసే ఛాన్సెస్ ఉంటాయి. ఫస్ట్ కమ్ విత్ దిస్. సో ఇక్కడ నేను హియర్ ఐఎమ్ టేకింగ్ డేటా పాయింట్ అండ్ ఐ అబ్జర్వ్ దట్ దిస్ ఈస్ క్లోజెస్ట్ టు దిస్ పర్టికులర్ క్లస్టర్ సిఎఫ్ టూ. ఇన్ దిస్ పర్టికులర్ లీఫ్ నోడ్ my data point is closest to this cluster. So what I need to do, I need to add this data point to cf2, right? Nenu nani cheptunne adi. So manaki teeskuna data point denike, because we are in the process of insertion, inserting into the tree. So manam teeskuna data point a cluster kaithe close ga undo aa cluster lo danni manam associate chestam. So before that we need to check the threshold of the cluster. So even after the addition of that point to this cluster does not changes the threshold. That means even if I am having some x point is there, x ni ee particular second cluster lo add chesin tarvata kuda threshold satisfy avutunte, still this new threshold, we are having such a new threshold is there after adding this, after updating this cluster two, we are having such a new cluster, new threshold. If this is still less than T given threshold, then there is no problem. There is no change in the tree. If at all it is not the case, suppose its threshold increases than the basic threshold, then what to do? We need to split the cluster into two clusters. So manu akada clusters ni two clusters kinda split chestam. That means what? Here we need to add another cluster, some CF L plus 1. Since we are having only CF 1, CF 2, up to CF L is there in this particular leaf node. So if at all it is greater than the threshold, we are adding one more cluster. That means we are making it into two clusters. So appude em avutundi, manam threshold ni satisfy cheyadaniki clusters ni split chestunnam. So threshold problem aipoyindi akkado. Ikkada inko kotta problem vachinda raledu. What is the new problem arises here? Since the L is the limit, L indicates the number of clusters in a leaf node. But here we are having L plus 1 cluster. If suppose L is equal to some 5 and we are having only 4 clusters here, in this particular leaf node we are having only 4 clusters, in such case there is no problem. There is no problem with the additional cluster. Ma, are you able to follow the class?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So if at all L value is 5, given L value is 5, and here in this particular leaf node 1, we are having only 4 clusters, there is no problem. In that case, there is no problem. And in koka cluster add aina sare, L ni satisfy chestundi kabatti akada split cheyalsina avasaram ledu. If this is not the case, suppose we are already having 5 clusters, 5 subclusters you are already having, and addition of one more cluster, what happens? It violates the rule L. Suppose this is rule L, this is rule B, this is rule T, just for our understanding purpose. So it violates the rule L. So then what to do in order to satisfy that? You need to split the leaf node into two nodes. That means what happened here? To satisfy T, we are splitting the cluster. Now to satisfy L, we are splitting the leaf node. That means we shouldn't add this here. We shouldn't add it here. Additionally, you need to create another leaf node. And here you can add this CF L plus 1. Here you can add. And you need to create this particular link to this parent node. So till now, we have some cases we have problem with the threshold, and we can clear that by splitting the cluster. And after that, you may have encountered a problem with the L, constraint L, and that can also be resolved by splitting the leaf node into two nodes. And coming to the next higher level, what is there? So here, since you have created one more leaf node, you have created, here you need to create one more entry. For that, one more leaf node, right? Suppose this is CF, since we are already having B entries, so this is CF B plus 1. So what happened here? Since we are already having B entries in the parent node, so with the addition of one more leaf node causes addition of one more entry in the parent node, which is CFB plus 1. So here also the same thing. If at all, if this parent node consisting of, suppose B is equal to 4, you are having three leaf nodes, then there is no problem. Addition of one more leaf node does not make any change. If at all the particular parent node consisting of number of leaves and addition of this particular leaf node violates the B rule, in that case, what we need to do? Again, we need to split the parent node into two nodes. This parent node is also splits into two nodes. That means here is 1 to B, and here we are having some B plus 1 CF, and this child is associated with this particular parent node. So what happened here? Since we are adding one more thing, and you need to have a link to its parent node. You need to have a link to its parent node. So here also same story. If at all it obeys, by adding this additional child, obeys the parent B rule, B in the sense branching factor, then there is no problem. If at all it is not obeying, again you need to split the parent node into two. Like that, what happened? You need to split the tree. Maybe it leads to the increasing the height of the tree. So in this way, you can dynamically insert the elements into the tree. So let me go with that slide. So here insertion, it starts with the root node and find the CF entry in the root closest to the data point. So for insertion, you need to search first, right? You need to search, the search starts from the root only. You need to search the similar kind of CF entry starts from the root node. And based on that, you need to follow that particular branch and you need to finally reach the child node. And there again, you need to backtrack by adding some element to that child node and branching the child node and again branching the parent node like this. So move to that child and repeat the process until the closest leaf entry is found. So once the closest leaf entry is found, if the point can be accommodated in the cluster, so this is what we have discussed till now. If the point can be accommodated in the cluster, update the entry. If this addition violates the threshold T, split the entry, right? If this addition violates the threshold, we need to split the entry. If this violates the limit imposed by L, split the leaf. Leaf node also we need to split. If its parent node is also full, split that parent node also. So like this, you need to update the CF entries, right? Every time, whenever you make a split, you need to update the CF entry from the root to the leaf to accommodate this point. So this is what about the CF insertion. And we are having four phases in this pitch algorithm briefly. First phase is loading into memory by building a CF tree. This can be done in first phase. And in the second phase, we are going to condense the tree into desirable range by building a smaller CF tree. And the third step is global clustering we need to make. And fourth step is also optional. This is clustering refinement, making good clusters. So we will discuss this in the next class. We are only having 2 minutes left. And probably in the next class, I will talk about the assignment I have given. Not 5 marks assignment, class assignment I am talking about. 43 members వచ్చారా? Let me take that in. దీంట్లో ఇంకెంతమంది ఫిల్టర్ అవుతారో చూద్దాం.